Welcome to another episode of The Brand Called You, a video and podcast show that brings you leadership lessons, knowledge, experience, and wisdom from hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Today, I'm privileged to have a very, very senior media professional with me, Pradeep Dwivedi. Pradeep, welcome to the show.
Good morning, Ashutosh. Thank you. And thanks for having me.
Thank you. Pradeep is the CEO India of Eros International Media, which is a massive body. And I think they've got the largest collection of films on a single platform. He's a business leader in digital media and digital media and entertainment industry. He is the vice president and area director of the International Advertising Association, and he's an angel investor. So Pradeep, tell me, what would you say are three key milestones in your career or your life?
I would say the first milestone is the fact that I had an upbringing which was in armed forces environment. I think living the first 18 years in Air Force cantonments across the country was the formative factor. The second was, I think as a professional, the multiple number of industries, starting from automotive to banking to telecom to now media and entertainment, that I've had an opportunity to work with. With perhaps exception of your good self, there are very few people who actually get to move across industries and do some very interesting thing while retaining the core. So I think that's the other milestone. The third has been obviously, on the family front, I have been blessed with a very loving family, and I'm privileged, and I thank God for the blessing that, you know, it has bestowed on me.
Fantastic. So, you know, I must comment on your first milestone. I always have a special bias to the Army or Navy or Air Force brats, if I call them, because my father was an Army officer and my wife's father was a naval officer. So always good to talk to someone who's from a defense background.
Thank you.
So Pradeep, let's talk now about Eros International. Okay. Tell me about the range of activities of Eros International in India and globally.
Certainly. So it's a very exciting place to be in. And everybody, as you rightly pointed out, everybody knows Eros as this large film studio, which has the largest library of films in India with a legacy of over 40 years, including movies that have been produced, co-produced, acquired and distributed worldwide. But very few people know that almost 70% of our business is actually outside of India.
Really?
We are the largest distributors of Indian film content worldwide, with connections in over 150 countries for theatrical distribution. Now, obviously, in the short time span of last 1 year, theatrical has been thrown out of gear.
Correct.
But notwithstanding that, we have platform arrangements with cable and satellite television channels, with digital platforms worldwide. So today, if you are an Indian and anywhere in the world you want to enjoy Bollywood entertainment, South Asian entertainment, Eros Now and Eros platforms are the options of choice. As an organization, we are incorporated in Isle of Man, listed in New York Stock Exchange.
Wow.
With a dual listed for the Indian entity, the Indian subsidiary where I am housed, at both NSE and BSE. I think by virtue of our global listing, we are close to $1 billion in terms of company valuation. And we've recently merged, very exciting news about 8 months ago, with a Hollywood studio called STX Entertainment.
Wow.
So now you have the best of Bollywood and the best of Hollywood coming together to create a digital future, not just in terms of content aggregation, impressive, compelling stories to come in, but also in terms of distribution worldwide, including emerging markets like China. I know China is a bit of a anathema when it comes to India right now.
Correct.
But I think we have to realize that the Asian sensibilities of content appreciation are very similar. And I think once we go beyond the political divide and, you know, socioeconomic challenges that we have, we will find that there are a lot of similarities that binds us together.
Correct. In fact, I've been to China many, many times, must be over 50, 60 times.
Right.
And I know the Chinese love Bollywood.
Oh, yes, right from Aamir Khan, Salman Khan, etc. are big, favorites there. But in spite of that, in addition to that, they are very appreciative of the kind of socio-cultural stories that we have.
Correct. No,
our emphasis on values, our emphasis on respect for family, respect for elders, connections between siblings. Those are very compelling notions that, you know, they relate to extremely well.
Very interesting.
And not only do we have dub content available, we have subtitle content available. And beyond the traditional means of distribution, we have also tied up with Chinese streamers. And China streamers is not the same as what you would find in the rest of the world, Aichi, etc. So that allows us access to the Chinese market in a completely different way.
Amazing. So, you know, When you talk of Eros International, you're in multiple formats, multiple countries. Tell me, how is digital media changing the traditional movie business and the television business? And of course, I know you're in Eros now, which is a very powerful OTT platform.
Right. So it is nothing short of tectonic. You know, it's like what you would talk about theories of the whole continent emerging out of shift of the plateau. I think the entertainment landscape is shifting like never before. I think digital is allowing the business to operate in a fundamentally different way in terms of allowing on-demand viewing versus appointment viewing, which was a traditional way of viewing content. I mean, we used to watch for a particular serial to come in. I remember in early 80s when Doordarshan had started in India, right from Chitrahar, which used to be in Wednesdays to Sunday movies. It used to be things that we used to wait for.
Yes.
So the audience of...
And we used to get Krishi Darshan in between.
Oh, yes. And yeah, Krishi Darshan, and for the new converts to television, I think even Krishi Darshan used to be exciting program.
You're right.
But now, obviously, the on-demand viewing has completely changed, so that audience is not only able to sift through from a supply ecosystem perspective, a very large amount of content that is being coming their way, but there are methodologies of filtration and selection of content that appeals to them. So I think, you know, there are these management theories about a segment of one. I think we are finally reaching that nirvana in entertainment where the marketing is going to deal with an audience or a segment size of one. And unless we are able to customize the content to meet the expectations of that audience segment of one, we will not be successful. Put it in other terms, I think the traditional formats of the time span, whether 2.5 to 3 hour movie or a television serial, which is 30 minutes, all of those are going away. Today, you have content from 5 minute snackable content to 12 to 15 minute quickies to 30 minute episodic content to 45 minutes longer webform content to short movies which are, you know, 1 hour and 1 hour 15 minutes to longer movies which are 2 hours and above.
And then and web series we go into 4 or 5 hours.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, and there is the interesting view of people watching it over a period of time versus doing binge watching. And that binge watching allows you to consume a very large format of content in a very short span of time. I think the other dimension that has really changed thanks to digital is the quality consciousness. Because the audience is picky and can choose what it wants to view, the producers of content are conscious of the fact that if they are not appealing to the audience by sheer sensibility, the quality of content, the storyline, the editing, the acting, all of it, they would lose the audience very quickly. And that has led to strong quality emphasis, both in terms of the talent that is coming into the industry, as well as the content that is getting produced. We believe that linear broadcast mechanisms such as television, etc., will give way completely to digital over a period of time. Live sports continues to be one area that gets cited as something that may perhaps not go the streaming way. But in spite of pandemic, we actually recently hosted one of our group companies, Eros Innovations, hosted a Mike Tyson, Ray Jones fighting bout in Los Angeles. And it had ticketed viewers all over the world. So even live sports is now going to go the digital way completely. Incredible. And I don't think there's any part of this business that will remain untouched.
Incredible. So, you know, let's talk OTT now. You know, I'm a subscriber to Eros now, and I see a lot of your content. With the incredible amount of competition that's coming in, how do different platforms survive? I mean, you know, there must be about 20 OTT platforms.
Yeah, closer to 50 now, actually.
Oh, 50 now, okay.
To be fair, in India itself. You know, compare this to a scenario, Ashutosh, like we had television networks, right? We started off with one Doordarshan, we went on to 3-4 networks. Today, you have nothing short of 300 channels that are there, and all of them are surviving with different levels of economics. So, if you leave the economics out of it, I think the diversity of content allows for some level of content selection and proliferation. From a channel sustainability perspective, most of these television channels have a combination of advertising funding, which increasingly is sort of you know, getting decayed down or paring down. And then there is people's willingness to pay for content. Mm. I think the a la carte pricing that TriHat has introduced for audiences today allows you to select the channels that you want to watch. Mm. Mm. Similarly, in case of OTTs, it is no different. I think it has started off quite like the way telecom started 2 decades ago. Mm. There is a vast market out there. If you just consider India, 1.4 billion, 1.3, 1.4 billion people, yeah. It's a bit of a land grab scenario. Whoever goes in first and establishes a recall will have a play. But again, going with the telecom scenario equivalent, from a scenario where you had 6 to 7 telecom operators to now having only 3, mm. there is a bit of a shakedown, there is a bit of a consolidation mm. that happens over a period of time, and I don't think that's inevitable as far as OTT is also concerned. Mm. Over a period of time, some platforms will start consolidating, and I think the winners in this case will be platforms that have the largest access to content across the board, mm. which is why we believe that the kind of content that we have and the kind of content library that we live with, which is irreplaceable and not easily recreatable, okay. right? Mm-hmm. I mean, if you are looking at a Hathi Mere Sathi of Rajesh Khanna and you want to watch that movie, mm-hmm. or if you want to watch a Bajirao Mastani, there is no way on earth you could do a teleserial out of it, but you will not get the same emphasis of movie. Or
correct.
Just for example, if you're looking at new age social movies like Shubh Mangal Savdhan or Shubh Mangal mm-hmm. Savdhan Zada, which mm-hmm. deals with issues like erectile dysfunction, you know, gay relationships, or mm-hmm. Vicky Donor, which is on sperm donation. Mm. All of these are movies where we have sort of been ahead of the times.
Correct.
And make sure that our audiences get something that is very interesting. And mm. that distinguishes Eros from just those run-of-the-mills production houses or studios that are only focusing on romance and romantic stories. That, mm. that obviously stays our
very, very interesting, because you almost taken the words out of my mouth, because I was, one of my questions I wanted to ask you was that cinema, TV, digital media mirrors right. what is happening in society. Sure. And has the power to influence thinking. What are your thoughts on this?
Absolutely. I think, you know, people think that cinema in a way is a lead indicator of the changes to be coming in, mm-hmm. and that cinema should reflect the desired state of where a society has to be. I think it is placing too much weightage on the shoulders of an industry that is really not that large. Mm-hmm. While, you know, optically it may appear that Bollywood has this huge cultural influence, and it does globally. But its ability to influence the underlying society is very subtle. Mm. I think more often than not, like Moon, what you see is reflection of the light that is coming back from the society. Mm. But I think it takes some level of courage to call it like it is and to be able to face some kind of resistance. I think in a society that increasingly goes towards some level of rigidity on certain aspects, mm. it can be a challenge, especially if you're dealing with mythological issues or issues that have cultural or religious sensitivity. Mm. But if you treat it maturely, and if you're honest as a filmmaker, if you're honest as a content creator and platform, I think you will find acceptance. And that is something that we firmly believe in. I think, you know, for the Eros Now platform itself, mm. we have content which, you know, transcends that cultural diversity and mm. thereby is able to appeal. The other thing for India that works is we have to go beyond the fact that Bollywood is just about Bombay or just mm. about Hindi films. Mm. You know, you look at the rich cultural heritage that our country has in right. Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam, Bangla, Gujarati, Punjabi, Marathi. Mm. And if you're able to tell stories out of that area, you have nothing short of a miraculous quality of correct. Content.
Correct.
And that's what we focus on.
Very, very interesting. So now, as someone who is handling such a major platform, my question to you is, what goes into making a great film or a great web series?
It's like the magic potion or the of Coca-Cola.
if everyone knew the answer, everyone would have it.
Yes. No, I don't think there is any science to it. There is a little bit of a science and a little bit of art, the way I see it. Mm. For me, fundamentally, and I think different people have different approach, there is no success formula. Mm. The primary thing that we at Eros look at, and I personally am very keen on, is how compelling the storyline is. Mm. Because the heart of any content is a story. And then obviously you layer it with renditions of what kind of directorial quality value add that you're getting, what kind of talent you're getting, how excited and enthusiastic mm. they are. But if the story doesn't tug at your heartstrings or appeals to your mind or appeals to your rational side, depending mm. on what the narrative is, I think rest all, you know, is downstream from there. From our perspective, we look at a storyline. Then we look at the talent and the team that is going to work with it. Obviously, as a studio, not all the content that we put out is home production. We mm-hmm. obviously do some bit of home production as well. Mm-hmm. But we have multiple external producers who we collaborate with, where they have creative liberty and creative license to tell the story like what is in their vision. Mm-hmm. And it is in our interest to let them have that creative freedom so that you have this difference of opinion coming in and you have this interesting set of content that is available for the audience.
Mm-hmm.
The other aspect that typically gets questioned, and you know, obviously in a commercial sense, people talk about how much money are you willing to spend.
Mm-hmm.
I think we've had movies where we have done the entire movie, just to give you a sense of the numbers, from a 5 crore movie to 150 crore movie. So that's,
wow.
You know, there's an order of magnitude difference between what you can potentially do mm-hmm. and put in. When you start off on the work, when you do a pre-development assessment, we typically look at an estimate based on the kind of distribution that we want to build up for that particular movie domestically, mm-hmm. globally, and across platforms, how much will go into satellite and
sure.
digital and theatrical platform. But really, the core fundamental is how compelling the story is. If the story is right, even though it may appear very simplistic, we may be willing to invest disproportionately on that.
Mm-hmm.
And we do that across the board.
Incredible. So I've got one more question for you on, you know, your work related, then I'll come to some questions for you personally. My question is now comes to what's very current, which is regulation of OTT platforms. What are your thoughts on that?
So I believe if you're living in a civilized society, there is a rule of law that needs to prevail.
Hmm.
I think the law must not be used to penalize people or stifle creative expression. People should have tolerance as prescribed in the values which are intrinsically Indian. And I will speak only from an India perspective.
Yeah.
Obviously, globally, there are a lot of views around it.
Mm-hmm.
I do believe that if you are starting out to make content with an intent of entertaining and with an intent of educating, I think you will perhaps not go wrong.
Okay.
The government's intent or the society's intent to regulate any industry is when it, you know, the concept itself comes in when it goes unregulated, mm-hmm. when it transcends boundaries that should not be bound. Commercially, if you ask me, the industry associations and the companies will say, okay, give us complete open land. It's like, and let us do everything under the sun that is there.
Mm-hmm.
I would say that, you know, while it is good for a company to have or an enterprise to have an open playing and a level playing field, I think it has to behave within the norms of the society in which it is living in.
Hmm.
And that does not mean being dogmatic about it, but it also means being practical to understanding the point of view with which you are making. You typically mirror and assume that the audience is exactly the same as you.
Hmm.
It may not be. It may come from a different set of geographies, upbringing, understanding, inference, and impact. And you have to be sensitive to that.
Very interesting.
And that's what we try to do.
Very interesting. So I'm going to now move to some other questions for you. Pradeep, you've been a media person, whether it's in the newspaper or in television, for some time. As an individual, what are the core values you believe in?
Fundamentally, I believe in the values of trust,
mm-hmm.
integrity, and being positive. I mean,
okay.
These three, I would say, are pretty core to me. I mean, when I work with my colleagues or my partners or my larger ecosystem in any business,
mm.
it is very important that I trust them first,
mm.
and not by way of any kind of a test or validation, mm. but have that implicit faith to begin with that every person wants to do the right thing,
okay.
wants to put the best foot forward,
mm.
and you have to give them a chance to do that.
Mm.
So, you know, everybody has my trust on day one, unless you break it, you know, and that's the way I would like to do.
Okay.
The concept of integrity is all about, it's not just about financial integrity. It is about being true to your commitment, being true to your word, being true to the promises that you make, and just being honest. I mean, if, and you know, it's like your integrity is tested when nobody is watching.
Mm.
What you do and your actions then reveal, you know, your the depth of your character. And I would assume that that is something that, you know, I'm able to live with myself, that when I look at the mirror, I know that what I'm doing is right and is not, you know, crossing the values that I hold dear. So those are some of the you know, core values that I
like. Very interesting. And, you know, you've been in so many organizations and you run businesses. What would you say is your leadership style?
My leadership style is lead from the front and very consensus oriented.
Okay.
I don't necessarily get into micromanaging or running the decision for everybody in the team, especially mm-hmm. at a leadership level. It is very important for me that people have their space and do what they do best. But when it comes to a business challenge or a business issue or a business initiative, I would rather, you know, get into it and at the absolute frontline level and do it by my own hand, because I cannot prescribe, teach, lead or motivate anybody to do anything unless I can prove that this is something that I have done or I can do it myself. So that's extremely important to me.
Okay. And, you know, this is the age of the millennials and the Gen Zs. Based on all your past experience with different age groups, how is this young community of people in India changing the entertainment business?
Oh, this is a massive change, both in terms of the supply side and the content creation, as well as the demand side and how they consume content. And when I say they, it feels a little odd to me because, you know, I mean, I'm 50 now, but in my mind, I'm still 23. I'm just coming out of a college and, you know, starting business school and starting off in my career. So what happens that time flies so quickly, you don't realize that, you know, decades have passed. And unless you are keeping your ears to the ground and engaging with the people, you are not able to learn that. You learn from your own kids. I mean, that's one, you know, in your face kind of a feedback. But I think it's very important for all of us, and I personally try to do that, is to stay connected to them, because you have to listen to their aspirations, their hopes and their concerns with what is going on. I think it would not be unfair to say that the millennials today are far more woke. We are far more liberal. We believe that we were the new age India, you know, coming out into 90s and, you know, post-liberalization transforming the fate of this country. But I think the baton has been passed on to a generation subsequent to that. I think, like the way you yourself pointed out, I think given your energy, you would be mistaken for a 16-year-old, and yet you work with a bunch of 20-year-olds who I'm sure would energize you so much.
Absolutely.
For the kind of work that you do. So even in our organization and in my teams, I try to make sure that we have younger people who bring completely different perspective, and you have to allow them the space to make their mark. That's extremely important.
Very nice. Very nice. So my next question is that, you know, Pradeep, as you look back at what is, you know, your life and you look ahead at all the things that you want to do and want to achieve, what does success mean to Pradeep?
Success for me would be making sure that I'm at peace with myself, which means that I believe I have done the best and I have done right by people who have been with me. Whether it's my family, whether it's my co-workers, whether it is my superior, whether it's my managers, promoters, business owners who have trusted me to run large businesses. And I think there is a sense of gratitude and there's a sense of being at peace with oneself that I associate with success. For me, material success is kind of immaterial. It is fine. It is coincidental. But it's ultimately, you know, being at peace and having that sense of gratitude and tranquility that defines
it. Very interesting. And a follow-up question to success is that, is who or what inspires you?
Everybody. You right now, your story before we started diving into this conversation will be so inspiring. If I can do half the or only one-fourth the activities that you've done all your life and the achievements that you've had, I'd consider myself as, you know, having lived a very interesting life. I think every manager that I've worked with has taught me something new. My co-workers, my colleagues. So I would say that, you know, every day is a wonder, and every person that you meet has a story and something of value to teach you. And I get inspired by all of that. And then there is the classic, there is the literature, the books that you read growing up. But if you were to look at an overwhelming influence, I think your entire life somehow gets dictated by the early formative years. I would say that my father and, you know, the hard work that you did, you know, three generations removed, almost all Indians were coming from an agricultural background of one way or another, agricultural or trading, right? So we are no exception. And I think for him to pull himself out of that scenario and build a life in armed forces, into engineering and doing the kind of interesting thing that he did was completely inspiring for me. And that led me to believe that anything and everything is achievable, provided we set our heart to it. And
very nice.
I've been blessed, so it's been nice.
Very nice. And my last question to you now, you know, there'll be many, many people who are going to sit and watch all everything that you're saying. My question is, what would your advice be to a young individual who's beginning to start off on their life in the corporate world?
My biggest advice would be, don't be afraid of adventures. Venture forth, take on whatever is coming your way. Don't try to predict or game where your life is going to head. Mm-hmm. You make this grandiose plan when you're young because you think your life will turn out in a predictable way. What you realize is that life throws challenges and opportunities to you at the most, curveball or spinball manner. Yeah. And it is not easy to predict all of them. Enjoy the moment. Enjoy the time that you have right now. Make sure that your day is counting and meaning for something. Mm-hmm. Plan for the future, but be prepared to amend yourself, because rigidity is going to be a challenge, and your flexibility and willingness to go with opportunities and make the best version of yourself is what is going to give you success, happiness, and a life that you'll be proud of.
Fantastic. Pradeep, thank you so much. I wish you, Eros, and everything else you are doing lots of success.
Thank you very much, Ashish. I really appreciate the opportunity. Have a nice day.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to The Brand Called You videocast and podcast, a platform that brings you knowledge, experience, and wisdom of hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Do visit our website, www.tbcy.in, to watch and listen to the stories of many more individuals. You can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Just search for The Brand Called You.